Shall we turn down our Bibles to Isaiah chapter 40? I'll read the odd number verses. Pastor John will lead the congregation in the even verses. Shall we stand as we read the Word of God? Comfort ye, my people, saith your God.
Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem, and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished, that her iniquity is pardoned, for she hath received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins.
The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God.
Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain.
And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it.
The voice said, cry. And he said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all the goodliness thereof is as the flower of the field.
The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people are as grass.
The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever.
O Zion that bringest good tidings, get thee up to the high mountain. O Jerusalem that bringest good tidings, lift up thy voice with strength. Lift it up, be not afraid. Say unto the cities of Judah, behold your God.
Behold, the Lord God will come with strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him.
He shall feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs with his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and shall gently lead those that are with young.
Who hath measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and meted out heaven with the span and comprehended the dust of the earth in a measure and weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance?
Who hath directed the Spirit of the Lord, or being his counselor, hath taught him?
With whom took he counsel, and who instructed him, and taught him in the path of judgment, and taught him knowledge, and showed to him the way of understanding?
Behold, the nations are as a drop in the bucket, and are counted as the small dust of the balance. Behold, he taketh up the isles as a very little thing.
And Lebanon is not sufficient to burn, nor the beast thereof sufficient for a burnt offering.
All nations before him are as nothing, and they are counted to him less than nothing and vanity.
To whom then will ye liken God? Or what likeness will ye compare unto him?
The workman melts a graven image, and the goldsmith spreads it over with gold, and he casts silver chains.
He that is so impoverished that he hath no oblation chooseth the tree that will not rot. He seeketh unto him a cunning workman to prepare a graven image that shall not be moved.
Have you not known? Have you not heard? Hath it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth?
It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, and the inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers, that stretcheth out the heavens as a curtain, and spreadeth them out as a tent to dwell in.
That bringeth the princes to nothing. He maketh the judges of the earth as vanity.
Yea, they shall not be planted. Yea, they shall not be sown. Yea, their stock shall not take root in the earth. And he shall also blow upon them, and they shall wither, and the whirlwind shall take them away as stubble.
To whom then will you liken me? Or shall I be equal, saith the Holy One?
Lift up your eyes on high, And behold, who hath created these things, that bringeth out their host by number. He calleth them all by names, by the greatness of his might, for that he is strong in power, not one faileth.
Why sayest thou, O Jacob, and speakest, O Israel, my way is hid from the Lord, and my judgment is passed over from my God?
Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding.
He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength.
Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall.
But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you are God and there is none like you. That what you have spoken, you shall surely bring to pass. We thank you, Lord, that as God, you know the end from the beginning, and that you have revealed in your word the end, even from the beginning. And now, Lord, help us to take heed to your word this day, that we might hide it in our hearts, that we might not sin against you, and that we might use your word as a lamp for our feet, a light for our path, that we might walk, Lord, in the light of your truth. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. In our journey through the Bible, we've come this week to the book of Ezra. And this week we are looking at the first three chapters of Ezra. John will be bringing us a commentary tonight from the first three chapters. But let me just say, it's all right if you sort of skip over chapter 2. It has just a lot of the names of the people and the families that returned from the captivity. And it can become laborious reading because the names aren't really relevant to us. There's only one portion that I found a little bit interesting, and that was in verses 61, 62. Of these families that returned, it said they sought their register among those that were reckoned by genealogy. That is, they were looking for their family records, but they were not found. Therefore were they as polluted, put from the priesthood. Now, there were those that said, well, we're of the tribe of Levi, but because they couldn't prove that they had genuine Levi genes, they were not allowed to be in the priesthood. So, we'd like you to look with us this morning, however, at Ezra chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Now in the first year of Cyrus, the king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled, the Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, the king of Persia, that he made a proclamation throughout all of his kingdom. He put it also in writing, saying, thus saith Cyrus, king of Persia, Jehovah God of heaven has given me all of the kingdoms of the earth, and he has charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. Notice this was in the first year of Cyrus, the king of Persia. Cyrus was the Persian general that conquered Babylon in the year 538 BC. For 2 years, he was a co-regent with Darius of the Medes. Darius died after 2 years, and so in the year 536 BC, Cyrus became the sole king over the Persian Empire. It was in this year, 536 BC, that he stood before the people and said that he had a commission from God to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. Now, when Nebuchadnezzar conquered over Israel, over Judah actually, and Jerusalem, it was the year 606 BC. That is when Daniel and his three friends, plus others, were taken as captives to Babylon, and when many of the treasures of Jerusalem were taken to Babylon, 606 BC, the first of the conquest of Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar. From 606 BC to 536 BC, the first year of Cyrus the king of Persia, was a period of 70 years. Now we read here that the first year of Cyrus, the king of Persia, that the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah might be fulfilled. Jeremiah had predicted that they would be 70 years in captivity to the Babylonians, so that the word of the Lord might be fulfilled by Jeremiah. In chapter 25, Jeremiah said, "And this whole land shall be desolate. Those who see it will be shocked at the desolations. And the people will serve the king of Babylon for 70 years. And it shall come to pass when the 70 years are over that I will punish the king of Babylon and the nation, saith the Lord, for their iniquity." In Jeremiah 29, verse 10, Jeremiah said, "For thus saith the Lord, that after 70 years have been completed at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you in allowing you to return to this place." Now, in the year 538 BC, when Darius was the king, and Daniel was placed by Darius in a very strategic position as one of the top governors over the Persian Empire, because Daniel had this position of power and authority, he had been reading the prophecies of Jeremiah. And Daniel, understanding by the prophecy of Jeremiah that the time of Babylonian captivity would be 70 years, and realizing that they were drawing close to that 70 years of captivity, it was now 68 years that they had been captive to Babylon, that Daniel began to seek the Lord with fasting and prayer. I believe that Daniel, because of his position, figured that perhaps the Lord would have him to play a key role in the repatriation to the land. And because of this, Daniel was just sort of making himself available to the Lord. He was seeking the Lord. "Lord, do you have any special instructions? Do you have a special work for me at this time?" And as he was seeking the Lord came and spoke to him about the future of Jerusalem and about the coming of the Messiah, telling Daniel the very day that the Messiah would make his entry into Jerusalem. As far as we know, Daniel did not really have much of a role to play. EZRA was the one who led the people back to the land. But they do say that Daniel brought to Cyrus, when he became the king in 536, the prophecy of Isaiah that convinced Cyrus that he was commissioned by God to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. But with Daniel, you know, I love to make myself available to God. realizing that we are in the last days because of the scriptures and what the Bible tells us will take place in the last days. And even as Daniel realized, he was in the last days of their captivity. They would soon be allowed to go back. Lord, is there anything that you have for me to do? Anything you want me to do? And I love that, just sort of making myself available to God for whatever God might have in mind, whatever he might want me to do, just being available. Now, under the law, in Exodus chapter 23, verse 10, God said to the people, you shall sow the land for 6 years and gather the fruit. But the seventh year, you shall let it rest and lie still, that the poor of the people may eat, and what they leave, the beasts of the field shall eat. And in like manner, you shall deal with your vineyard and with your olive orchards. That is, you're to gather of the fruit for 6 years. You're to plant the fields for 6 years. But the seventh year was to be a Sabbath or a rest for the land. They weren't to pick the fruit. They were to leave it for the poor. They weren't to plant the fields. God said, I'll give you enough in the sixth year that'll carry you over. In Leviticus 25, God repeated it. He said, speak to the children of Israel, say unto them, when you come into the land which I give you, then shall the land keep a Sabbath unto the Lord. 6 years you shall sow your field, and 6 years you shall prune your vineyard and gather the fruit from it. But the seventh year shall be a Sabbath of rest unto the land, a Sabbath for the Lord. You shall neither sow your field nor prune your vineyard. In Leviticus chapter 26, God declared to them that if they wouldn't listen to him, but if they walked contrary to his law, that this is what he would then do. He said, I will bring the land into desolation. Your enemies which dwell there will be astonished at it. I will scatter you among the heathen. I will draw out a sword after you, and your land will be desolate and your cities laid waste. And then shall the land enjoy her Sabbaths as long as it lies desolate, and you will be in your enemies' lands. Then shall the land rest and enjoy her Sabbaths as long as it lies desolate. It shall rest because it did not rest in your Sabbaths when you dwelt upon it. Israel became a kingdom in the year 1095 BC. Saul was crowned as the king over Israel. From 1095 BC to 605 BC, we have actually 490 years. During this 490 years of the kingdom of Israel, they did not keep this law of God. They planted and they picked of the crop year after year after year for 490 years, totally disregarding the commandment to give the land rest every seven years. So 490 years, the land did not have its rest. And so God said, all right, I'm going to let you be carried off into Babylon and into other nations for 70 years, because 490 divided by 7 would give you 70 years of Sabbaths that were coming to the land. If you will not give the land the rest, if you will not obey my voice, then God said, I'll take care of it myself. And so the 70 years of captivity, 1 year for every 7 years that they did not obey the commandment of God to give the land rest. There's an old Greek proverb that says, the dice of the gods are loaded. By that, the Greeks meant, you really can't go against the word of God and hope to prosper. If you go against the word of God, you can be certain that you'll be the loser. One way or another, God will extract his portion. Now, our text reads, in the first year of Cyrus, the king of Persia. There is another interesting prophecy about this particular period of history, this particular year when Cyrus was the king of Persia. It is found in Isaiah, the prophet, who was writing 150 years before Cyrus was ever born. And 150 years before this man was ever born, in the prophet Isaiah, chapter 44, beginning with verse 24, thus saith the Lord, your Redeemer, the one that formed you in the womb. I am the Lord that made all things, the one that stretched out the heavens, that spread abroad the earth. I turn wise men backward and make their knowledge foolish. I confirm the word of my servants, and I perform the counsel of my messengers. I say to Jerusalem that you will be inhabited, and to the cities of Judah you will be built, for I will raise up the desolate places. I say of Cyrus, remember this is 150 years before he was born, you are my shepherd. You shall perform all my pleasure, saying unto Jerusalem, you shall be built, and to the temple your foundations shall be laid. Thus saith the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held to subdue the nations before him. I will loose the loins of kings. You remember when Cyrus took the city of Babylon, that night Belshazzar, the king, was having a feast for his lords, and suddenly there came a finger writing on the plaster of the wall, the cryptic message that he could not understand. Daniel interpreted it for him. But as that writing came on the wall, this drunken king suddenly began to shake. It says his knees began to smite against each other. Loose the loins of kings, God said. And I will open before him the two levee gates. In the center of the city of Babylon, there was a bridge that spanned over the Euphrates River. On either side of the bridge, there were gates. And on this particular night, at night, the gates would be shut and locked. But on this particular night that Cyrus came in and conquered Babylon, those gates were left open because the guards were so drunk, they didn't bother to lock them that night. I will open to you the levee gates, they will not be shut. I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of brass. I will cut in two the bars of iron. I will give to you the treasures of darkness, the hidden riches of the secret places, that you may know that I, Jehovah, who call you by your name, I am the God of Israel. For Jacob, my servant's sake, for Israel, my elect, I have called you by your name. I have named you, though you have not known me. I am Jehovah. There is no other God beside me. And so when Daniel brought this prophecy to Cyrus and said, hey, man, your name is in our book, and here's what God says about you. In the first year that Cyrus was the king of Persia, the word of the Lord might be fulfilled by Jeremiah that there would be 70 years of captivity. The Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, the king of Persia. He made the proclamation throughout the kingdom. He put it in writing. Thus saith Cyrus, the king of Persia, Jehovah God of heaven has given me all of the kingdoms of the earth, and he has charged me to build him a house at Jerusalem, which is in Judah. This is another one of those places in the Bible where God proves that he is outside of our time domain. That God outside of time sees the end of things from their beginning. He is the eternal God outside of time. And it's one of the places where he proves it. And by declaring with accuracy things that would happen in the future long before they ever took place, declaring the end from the beginning. He proves that he is God, that he is outside of our time domain, and that he is the eternal God. In Isaiah 46, 9, he said, I am God, and there is no other. I am God, there is none like me. I declare the end from the beginning, and from ancient times I have spoken of things that have not yet come. And I declare that my counsel shall stand. Interesting. God declares there's none like me. I'm going to tell you the end of things from the beginning. And as we look at the Bible, it actually tells us of things that are still yet future. What's going to happen to this world? What's going to happen, with Israel and with the things that are taking place in our world today? What's going to happen with the European community? What does the future hold? Interesting. God has told us of these days in which we live. We can easily tell whether or not it is God's word. If it comes to pass, God spoke it. If it didn't, then God didn't speak it. Jeremiah said there'll be 70 years in captivity. Now the 70 years are over, and Cyrus makes the decree that allows them to return to Jerusalem and rebuild the city. The Bible helped Daniel to understand the events that were taking place in his day, because God had spoken of those events before they ever happened. And thus Daniel, because he was a student of the Bible, knew exactly what was going to be happening, and thus he began to seek the Lord to make himself available. The Bible should help us to understand the events that are taking place in the world in which we live today. And by knowing these things, as Daniel, we should get on our faces before God to present our bodies to God as living sacrifices, that they might be instruments that God can use in these last days. God said, my word shall stand. That is, you can count on my word. It will come to pass. It will stand. Joshua, when he stood before the people at the end of his career, said to them, there has not failed any of the good things which the Lord has spoken unto the house of Israel. All of it has come to pass. That was up to the days of Joshua. Some 400 years later, King Solomon said to the people, blessed be Jehovah that has given rest to his people Israel. According to all that he promised, there has not failed one word of all of the good promise which he promised by the hand of Moses, his servant. So here is witness. These men are witnessing. God's word has been fulfilled. Not one word has failed. The prophet Balaam said, God is not a man that he should lie, neither is the son of man that he should change. Has he spoken, and shall he not do it? What he has spoken, shall he not make his word good? God spoke of the last days, the days in which we are living. Jesus spoke of a time when men would develop such weapons of destruction that they would threaten the very existence of man upon this planet. Jesus said, unless those days would be shortened, there would be no flesh that would remain on the planet Earth. The Bible spoke of the days, the last days, when money will be done away with as a medium of exchange, and that all of your exchanging will be done with a number that is placed in your right hand or in your forehead. That has not yet happened, but we surely do see the precursors of that in our society today. He spoke of the last days when Israel would become a nation once again. But then he also spoke of the turmoil that would take place when Israel became a nation and the trouble that she would have with her surrounding neighbors. He spoke of the last days when Israel would be invaded by a horde of Muslim nations. And of course, Israel is a nation. She has not yet been invaded by the Muslim nations, but as we look at the Middle East today, we realize that this could happen at any time. The Lord spoke of the last days where there would be a distress of the nations because there seemed to be no way out of their dilemma. And surely today, economically and so many ways, our nations are facing a real problem, distress, but there doesn't seem to be any answers. He spoke of the last days when Europe would become a united community. He spoke of the last days when men would be lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. Surely, as we look at our world today, God, from the beginning, has described the things that would mark the end of the age of man and the beginning of the glorious new age when the kingdom of God shall reign over the earth. That phrase, that the word of the Lord might be fulfilled. Do you realize how completely God has fulfilled his word? What Solomon said, not one word has failed, can be declared today, some 3,000 years later. Not one word of all that God has said has failed. Realizing, as God said, my word shall stand. What I have said, I will do. Realizing the certainty of God's word, if I were not a Christian, it would scare the hell out of me. And I mean that literally. For Jesus said, I say to you, my friends, don't be afraid of those that can kill your body, but after that they have no power. But fear him, which after he has killed the body has the power to cast you into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. In Galatians chapter 5, Paul describes some of the hellish traits that are in man. The hellish traits that will keep a man from entering the kingdom of heaven. And as he gives a list of these things, he talks about sexual immorality. He talks about impurity, of wantonness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. And Paul then said, I warn you again, as I have warned you in the past, that they who do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven. Mark that well. You may want to go over that list again in the quietness of your own meditation this afternoon, Galatians chapter 5, beginning with about verse 17, where Paul talks about the works of the flesh and he contrasts them with the fruit of the Spirit. In the book of Revelation, chapter 20, verse 14, the Lord said, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire, and this is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. And finally, in Revelation 21:7, the Lord said, he that overcomes shall inherit all things. I will be his God, he will be to me a son. But the fearful, the unbelieving, the abominable, the murderers, the whoremongers, the sorcerers, the idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Two groups, those that are saved, those that are not saved. Those who are walking after the Spirit and those that are living after the flesh. Two destinies, heaven and hell. And by my own deliberate choice, I am in one of the two groups today. Those who are still bound by the desires of their flesh and slaves to that are those who have received forgiveness from their sins through Jesus Christ. I know which group I am in. In what group are you today? I think of God's cry through Ezekiel to the people, where he said, "As I live, saith the Lord, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked would turn from his way and live. Turn ye from your evil ways, for why will you die?" Interesting question. When God has provided forgiveness of sin, when God paid such a price to redeem you from the power of sin, why should you die in sin? Now again, God's word shall stand. What God has declared shall indeed come to pass. It has proven true in the past, and you can be certain it will prove true in the future. What God has said shall indeed be. And you and I are in one category or the other. How important that we take the Word of God that promises us that if we would believe in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead and confess him as our Lord, that we would be saved from the judgment and the wrath of God to come. God's word shall stand, and you can count on that. And I find assurance in that today. The blessed assurance. God has promised me salvation, and my hope is in the promises of God and the word of God, which will come to pass. And thus I have such great confidence and assurance of my salvation. But if you're not saved, you can be just as confident that the judgment of God will come upon you and you will spend eternity separated from his love. Your choice. Let's pray. Father, help us to realize how awesome is the responsibility of choice that you have given to us. That in reality, Lord, we choose our own destinies by either accepting or rejecting your only begotten Son, who you sent to die for our sins. Lord, you promised that you would send the Deliverer. You promised that you would send your Son. You promised that he would take all of our sins and iniquities, and Lord, you kept your promise. Jesus came. He bore our sins in his own body. And you promised, Lord, that if we would believe in him, we would not perish but have everlasting life. And so today, Lord, as people are in the balances, making their choice, to live after the Spirit of God and to serve God, or to live after the lust of their flesh and be a slave to their flesh. Lord, we pray that you will awaken us to the reality of the future and the destiny of those who reject Jesus Christ. Impress our hearts, Lord, with the truth of your word this day, knowing that your word shall stand. May we then, Lord, make the right choice. In Jesus' name, amen. Shall we stand? Your destiny is in your hands. God has given you the capacity of choice. The Lord said, choose this day whom you will serve, whether it be your flesh or whether it will be God. The pastors are down here at the front this morning. They're here to pray for you. Those who the Spirit of God has been speaking to your heart and saying, look, it's time to get on the right side. We're coming to the end of the road. You don't have much time left. It's time to make your life available to God, that God might use you as he desires in these last days. And so as soon as we're dismissed, I would encourage you that you come on forward and that you surrender your life to Jesus Christ. These men are here to pray with you and to help you to discover that glorious life that God wants you to know and God wants you to have, the life that was purchased for you by Jesus Christ, his Son. If you would like to know that your sins have been forgiven, if you'd like to have the assurance that if you would die today, you would spend eternity with God in his eternal kingdom, then I would encourage you, come on forward and let the Spirit of God just really transform your life and make you all that he wants you to be as you surrender your life to him. Now may the Lord be with you, watch over and keep you in his love, and fill you with his Spirit in Jesus' name. The Lord bless thee,
Lord bless thee
and keep thee.
And keep thee.
The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. And be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace.
And now, on behalf of The Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact The Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.